Hello, my name is Frank Olson. I'm the Crop Economist and Marketing Specialist with NDSU Extension. This session is the wheat market outlook for 2020-21 marketing year. I'd like to begin with a few comments about what's happening in the broader crop market area that is impacting not only wheat, but also corn and soybeans. The first is the impacts of COVID-19, and in particular on what's happening with U.S. economic growth. We had obviously a recession that was confirmed when we had the economic shutdown. We've had a recovery since our economy is beginning to reopen, but the recovery levels when you're monitoring economic performance in the U.S. has not been to the levels we saw pre-COVID. And the expectation is that the economic growth in the U.S. will likely flatten out or have a very, very slow growth until we have vaccines that are readily available for the general public. And based on the health officials right now, based on what we know today, it looks as like that will happen likely in midsummer of 2021. So from here into 2021, midsummer, once we get the vaccines, we may see a little bit more rapid growth as we move forward in time. But right now, the economic growth domestically will stay relatively stable. Now, that's having an impact on the U.S. dollar and the value of the dollar relative to other currencies. Once again, the U.S. dollar is expected to remain relatively stable for the next several months. We've seen a retracement. We've seen a dropping of the U.S. dollar value relative to other currencies. It's not at a low level historically, but it's certainly not at the levels that we saw pre-COVID when the economy was going much stronger. So again, this will hopefully help us in particular with wheat exports, because wheat exports tend to be very sensitive to the value of the U.S. dollar relative to the other exporting countries. One of the other things I want to just remind everybody, please be cautious and aware there might be some supply chain disruptions within the crop sector. I'm not expecting anything widespread, nothing like we saw in the livestock sector and livestock processing at the slaughter plants this summer, but there might be individual companies that have some troubles along the way. I've had discussions with general managers and CEOs of different companies around the region, local elevators, processing plants, et cetera, where they're concerned about employee absenteeism, that the employees are getting sick, and either they're getting sick and having to stay at home because they're not feeling well, or that they have been exposed to someone and have had to go into quarantine. And of course, this is having a disruption in the flow of normal work activities within these companies. So please be aware that if something happens, please be patient, be willing to try and work around the situation. We're all trying to make this make things work as smoothly as possible. So again, there might be some local supply disruptions. I don't expect to see anything major within the grain system. From an export pace standpoint, the economic conditions, some of the things that I'm watching, not only in what's happening in China, but also, more importantly, what's happening in some of our other major trading, agricultural trading partners like Mexico, Japan, Philippines, European Union. And again, all three of those countries, Mexico, Japan, and the Philippines, are major wheat buyers from the United States. And so, again, the concern is because of COVID-19, and more importantly, because of the economic recession that's going on globally, that some of these countries have been hit pretty hard. And there's some concern or question about how strong will that demand base be? Will they continue to buy U.S. agricultural products even though their economy is slowing? Again, we'll have to wait to see, but it is something that I'm watching very, very closely. I get quite a few questions about what's happening between the U.S. and China on trade tensions. Given what we know today, given the current political as well as economic environment, those tensions are expected to remain at a very high level. Even though we've had the election now, it looks as though there's going to be a slight shift in our policy internally in the country, but also in our trade policy. Those trade tensions between the U.S. and China will remain high. I mean, I don't see any major shift in the aggressive nature that we've had. What does that mean for agricultural trade policy? Right now, again, from a policy standpoint, I don't expect to see anything change quickly. Whenever we talk about trade and trade relations, typically those happen over time. Sometimes we get shocks to the system like we saw over the last couple of years, but usually when we start renegotiating or negotiating new trade agreements, that can take months and many times years to be able to work out. So right now, I don't expect to see any major shifts, but those tensions will remain high and we have to watch that very closely. I'm also watching what's happening in Europe, in particular with Brexit, where the British economy is trying to separate itself from the European economy, the European Union. Those negotiations are ongoing. There's a deadline coming up very soon to have those negotiations completed. It will, in my opinion, have an impact on, potentially an impact on U.S. agricultural trade. Britain has already started negotiating a trade agreement with the United States, separate from the European Union. I do expect those negotiations to pick up fairly quickly once they get past the Brexit portion of this. So again, they're negotiating how is Britain going to interact and trade back and forth with the European Union on this on these new terms. Now, the other thing that has probably a hidden effect is what does this Brexit agreement do to the value of the euro? Because in many cases, the euro is considered to be the reserve currency or that alternative currency to the US dollar when it comes to global trade. And so there's this kind of interaction that goes on between what happens in Europe and the value of the euro, as well as what happens then with the value of the US dollar, and which of those is a more stable platform to be able to trade globally. So there are some things that I'm watching. Again, they may not have the big shock value that a lot of people were kind of expecting. And to be honest, I hope that doesn't happen. I hope things go relatively smoothly and we're able to work this out. So let's dive right in and talk a little bit about what's happening on the supply-demand front. This is the supply and demand estimates that USDA prepared for the November WASDE, or the World and Agricultural Supply and Demand Estimates. I'm going to be focusing on the far right-hand column, which is the numbers that came out in November. We've got the columns in the middle, which are the last marketing year. The marketing year for wheat starts on June 1 and runs through the end of May. And so we're partway through, not quite halfway through the marketing year for wheat. The middle column is last year's numbers, and of course, the far left-hand column is 2 years ago. We can use those as reference points. The far right-hand column being the November numbers, there wasn't really any major shock or changes between the October estimates and the November estimates for wheat. There were some surprises for corn and soybeans, and of course, as corn and soybeans have come up, the wheat market's been pulled with it. But from a pure supply-demand standpoint, there weren't a lot of shifts or adjustments between October and November. So our expectations haven't changed a lot. So we drop right down to the bottom line. Small changes, small revisions. The ending stocks for wheat were tightened up just a little bit, but not dramatically from October to November. Now, we did have a reduction from September to October. So in the September estimates, our ending stocks were forecast to be about 925 million bushels versus the current forecast of about 877 million bushels. Now, 877 million bushels is still substantial. It's still comfortable, I guess, if you want to use that word for the ending stocks numbers, but not as large as it has been the last couple of years. Again, if you were to look at what happened in 2018 as well as 2019. Right now, because we have the harvest out of the way, a lot of the winter wheat has already been planted. We won't get any updated information on winter wheat seedings until January of 2021. So right now, the focus is really on the consumption part. How quickly are we using up the wheat that we produced? We have major sources. USDA kind of puts these into different categories or buckets. The red line on top that bounces around is exports. And again, year-to-year changes in exports. The blue line is what they call food usage, or basically domestic milling. The black line on the bottom is feed usage, or technically it's feed and residual. And then the gold line is seed. The little dots on the far right-hand side are the current USDA forecast for the upcoming marketing year. As you can see, the blue line, which is again domestic milling, is a very large number. Usually makes up about 50% of our total wheat consumption, but is relatively stable. So again, domestically, we don't typically see big changes or shifts in the amount of wheat that goes into the milling industry and into our food products. But the one thing that does bounce around is much more difficult to predict, of course, is exports, which is the red line. Now, the last several years, if you notice about the last 4 years, the export levels for U.S. wheat have started to stabilize. And there's a significant reason for that, primarily because of the expansion and resurgence of the Russian wheat market. So again, Russia is starting to overtake the United States as the largest exporter of wheat in the world. And so what happens now in Russia is having a much larger impact on our domestic prices. And I'll talk about that in more detail in just a moment. So fortunately, we do get weekly updates on the amount of wheat that we're exporting. The red line is where we're currently at through the end of October, which is the most recent information we have as of this recording. This is cumulative exports. So this would be actual wheat that has gotten onto a vessel and left the country. And again, so every time that we have an export sale, every time that we have a loading, the value gets added to the pile. What we'd like to see is these pile of exports grow as fast as possible. As you can see, the last several years, almost a straight line, very stable. Week-to-week export levels have been relatively stable over time, and also from year-to-year export levels. It's not until we get late in the season that we start to see these export levels change from year to year. So early on in the season, very stable. We're pretty much right on track with the export pace that we've seen the last couple of years. Now, this is for all wheat exports. Again, all wheat. I'm going to talk a little bit about spring wheat in more detail in just a few moments. So when we start looking at who buys U.S. wheat, number one customer has been Mexico, at least for the last several years. Again, export sales into Mexico have been slowly growing over the last several years. That's primarily winter wheat, a lot of soft red winter wheat, but also quite a bit of hard red winter wheat. They do import a little bit of hard red spring wheat, but not large levels. Philippines is really the big spring wheat buyer, but they also buy a lot of white wheat, in particular from the Pacific Northwest. And of course, the third largest is Japan. Japan has been a very strong wheat buyer of the United States for many, many, many years. Again, buying both a blend of hard red spring as well as hard red winter wheat, as well as some white wheat, again, out of the Pacific Northwest. So big three countries, Mexico, Philippines, and Japan. As I noted earlier, in particular, Mexico and the Philippines have been hurt pretty hard by the COVID-19 and the global recession. And so I do have some concerns about longer term, what might be happening within their countries. So far, if you look at the far right-hand column, which is export commitments, again, that would be not only the amount that they've already purchased and has been delivered, but also for those bushels that have been purchased and not delivered yet. So it's a summation of all of those. We're pretty much right on pace. I mean, the buying rate, the purchase levels and the amount that is going into the Mexico, Philippine, and Japanese markets have been relatively stable. Nigeria is a little bit behind. Korea is actually ahead of normal right now. So when we look at total export pace, I mean, how fast or where are we at normally at this time of year? Kind of right on pace. The countries that are coming in and buying U.S. grain, in particular U.S. wheat, have been buying U.S. wheat kind of at that normal rate. There are some global tensions that are starting now to appear and potentially impacting the wheat market specifically. One of these you may have heard a little bit about is the trade tensions and political tensions between Australia and China. China recently put an import ban, literally banned imports of Australian barley, sugar, red wine, timber, coal, lobster, copper ore, and copper concentrates. And again, for agriculture, as you notice, several of those are agricultural products. There are rumors now being floated around that wheat might be added to that list of banned imports. And China historically has bought quite a bit of wheat from Australia, in particular some of their white wheats, but some of them are hard wheats that are used for bread and bread products as well. There was also recently an announcement by Russia that they were going to put an export quota in, basically a cap. On the maximum amount of grains that would leave the country. That cap is about 15 million metric ton. That cap really is for the time period from middle of February through June of next year. So it hasn't really been in effect yet. But the reason they're putting this export quota on or limiting the amount of grain exports is to make sure that they limit any kind of price increases that's going on domestically because of COVID-19. Again, the main reason is that with COVID-19, the domestic market is becoming important. They want to maintain low domestic bread prices as well as grain prices. And if they start exporting too much, those price levels will start to increase. So I really don't think that we're short-term we'll see an impact of this export quota, but it may become more significant later on in the season. As we get closer to, again, that spring's work time period, as the winter wheat, both in the United States as well as Russia start to break dormancy, and we get a better read on what the size of the Russian wheat crop might be, I really don't think that these quotas will become a market driver, a price influence until later on in the spring. There has been some discussion about what's happening with soil moisture conditions and dry conditions in particular southern Russia, which is their primary winter wheat growing region. So this is a soil moisture map, a groundwater map. So this would be drought indicator. It's within the top 1 meter of soil, about the top 3 feet of soil. In this blue, I've tried to highlight the major wheat growing region, not only in Russia, which is up here, but also in southern Russia, which is the hard red winter wheat region, but also in Kazakhstan. Kazakhstan is the border between Russia and Kazakhstan is where they grow their spring wheats, the hard red spring wheat, similar to this hard red spring wheat we grow here. Now, the Black Sea is located right here, so it's just on the edge of the map. Notice that as we get into southern Russia right here, which is, again, their big winter wheat, hard red winter wheat producing region, that's where they export most of their wheat. Soil moisture conditions are relatively dry, and again, that's a concern about how many acres of wheat will actually get planted. And then more importantly, what will happen over the winter with winter kill and crop conditions as they start to break dormancy next spring. This next map shows Europe. This country on the far right-hand side is Ukraine. Also notice Ukraine is a major export competitor for hard red winter wheats, and it's right next door to southern Russia. So again, the conditions that are going on here in Ukraine are also spilling over into the southern Russia region. Again, very dry in this area. Concerns about how many acres of winter wheat will actually get seeded because it is so dry, farmers may not plant winter wheat and wait until spring and plant an alternative crop like corn or soybeans. Another region we're watching is what's happening in Europe. France is the largest wheat producer in Europe, followed closely by Germany. France is a major exporter primarily of a wheat similar to our soft red winter wheat. Again, as I'll show in a moment, Europe is kind of a major exporter for wheat and a competitor for us in the global market. Again, very dry conditions in both the breadbasket of France as well as parts of Germany. So these are things that the market's talking about. My opinion is that it really won't start impacting pricing until we get into the spring timeframe when we start breaking dormancy. If we turn specifically to hard red spring wheat, again, hard red spring wheat sales have been okay, but not fantastic. Not quite as good as we saw in the 2016-17 time period, but again, a little bit better than what we've seen for this time of year compared to the last couple of years. So again, it's good, but not fantastic. The question I have is, okay, who's buying the spring wheat? And again, when you look back historically, Philippines is the dominant buyer of U.S. spring wheat. We compete with the Canadians into that market, but the Filipinos tend to have a preference for U.S. spring wheat versus the Canadian spring wheat. Again, number one buyer, when you look at their current purchasing relative to what they have done in the past, they're pretty much right on track, if not a little bit of ahead. When we look at total sales into Japan and Taiwan, which are number two and number three customers, pretty similar to what we've seen in the past. Again, not very aggressive purchasing. But I do think that might pick up later on in the season. Again, we'll have to wait to see. Been some discussion about Chinese purchases of spring wheat. If you go back to that 16-17 time period when we saw a little bit more aggressive spring wheat sales, part of that reason was because China came in and bought some U.S. spring wheat. Now, again, for the spring wheat market, this is a bit of a surprise. China has been purchasing some hard red winter wheat. Winter wheat exports have been relatively strong compared to history into the Chinese market, but they're still much lower than we see for corn and soybeans. So far this season, again, there has been some buying interest, bigger than we've seen the last couple of years, but well behind the pace that we saw in the 2016-17 time period. So again, if there are some issues that show up between trade tensions between Australia and China, we may see China come back and buy some U.S. hard red spring wheat to backfill some of those supplies. Just want to remind everybody about who we compete with. Who are the other major competing countries that we have to sell against? And again, just to remind everyone, Russia now has become the largest exporter of wheat in the world. They passed us here a couple of years ago in the United States. Usually the United States historically has been number one, but back in 2016-17, and then into 17-18, the exports from Russia far surpassed the United States. European Union, some years, if they have large supplies, if they have a really good wheat crop, they'll be more aggressive sellers into the global market. The Russian wheat tends to be like a hard red winter wheat. The European wheat, more like a soft red winter wheat. And so it depends a little bit upon who's selling and what countries are interested in what types of wheat. Again, just to remind everybody, Canada, major wheat exporter, major competitor, primarily a hard red spring wheat and durum exporter. The lion's share of these export levels are for hard red spring wheat. So again, major competitor for us. Ukraine is come on board. Again, not as the expansion hasn't been as rapid as what we saw in Russia, but it is something that they've become more consistent supplier. The quality parameters and the consistency of the product that they're delivering is more uniform than it has been in the past. The last couple of years, Australia has had actually 3 years of continuous drought. Finally, in 2021, they had a reasonable year. They do have exportable stocks. The supplies are there. Again, logistically, they have a real competitive advantage going into those South Asian markets like the Philippines, like Japan, like Korea. Again, if there gets to be some very strong trade tensions between between Australia and China, these export levels may not be reached. So there might be a little bit of a shift or adjustment. This year, Argentina has had a very poor winter wheat crop. I do expect the forecast for winter wheat exports out of Australia to continue, or Argentina, excuse me, to continue to drop as we move through time. So again, primarily a hard red winter wheat exporter. A lot of that winter wheat goes into Brazil. Brazil may come to the U.S. to backfill some of those lower supply levels. Again, we'll have to wait to see. If we look at U.S. ending stocks, now again, this is all wheat classes combined. The red line is wheat consumption and total wheat usage, both domestic consumption and exports. The green line is U.S. wheat production. The blue lines on the bottom are carryover stocks or stocks to use ratio. Once again, if we take our ending stocks divided by our total use, that percentage represents what percentage of our total needs are in reserve or in storage just before harvest of the next marketing year. And as you can see, we were building wheat inventories fairly quickly. And again, part of that is because Russia was entering the global wheat market. They were being very, very competitive, pushing out some of our traditional suppliers. We started building our carryover stocks. Our total planted acreage started to drop. We've been able to bring our ending stocks down, but not to the levels that we've seen, kind of what I would consider to be long-term normal, which would be in that 30 to 35% range versus about 42% that we see today. If we look at hard red spring wheat specifically, again, we're starting to take our ending stocks down, but we're still very, very flush with winter wheat. Again, this year we've had a reasonably good production year. Yields were pretty normal. Our quality profile was very good. That should help us be able to meet the quality specifications for some of the buyers. But again, we've got adequate supplies. The bins are not running empty. The Canadians also had a very good spring wheat crop this year. And so I do think the price competition for hard red spring wheat in the global market will continue to be pretty intense. So I think there might be some opportunities. The right now, the short term, the big mover in the wheat market is really the following of corn and soybeans as we move forward. So again, there's this interaction that goes on between these different major export or major products, agricultural products we produce in the United States. So with that, I'd like to thank you for listening. Hopefully you'll have some questions. We'll be able to have some online discussion about what's happening, and I'll be able to provide some additional update in the near future. So thank you very much.